Hey there, it's Brett Chittum with Lawrence Systems, and I'm here with Tom Lawrence, and we're kind of doing a coffee talk here. And we're really actually want to talk about how much per seat do you charge? And Tom and I have had a lot of discussion in this. We've also seen this in forums, on Facebook forums, on Tom's forum. It's everywhere because people are always trying to figure out, well, how much do I charge? What am I going to make? How much am I going to make? And I think that's a great topic to really delve into today. So, Tom, what do you think?
I think the first question, because this comes up, how much do you charge, is not the right question, because you're starting out with this whole what not knowing what you're offering and making a lot of assumptions. So I've seen people claim, oh, I'm getting X dollars per head or per seat, per person, however you do your pricing models. But you'll see people with wildly different offerings. You're like, hold on, this person's charging $50 a month per person. This person's charging $500 per month per person. But it comes down to what are they bundling in and offering for those services? And one of the things that I've seen a lot of MSPs do, and this is fine, and there's a lot of there's reasons to do this, but there's reasons sometimes we don't do this. It comes down to what you want to do is they try to offer everything they possibly can. They take over the phone bill, the internet bill, as many things as they can, they put under their roof. So not just like fixing the computers or managing computers or, you know, managing security on computers, but to go a step further to do everything from certain levels of auditing, certain levels of compliance monitoring, even like I said, right down to, I've seen someone that said they offered some of the accounting services bundled in with their MSP. So of course you're going to get more per seat because you're taking the burden off. And that's what business owners are looking at. Even you as an MSP business owner, IT business owner, you probably don't do everything in-house. You outsource certain functions. So businesses decide what's worth it to have in-house and what's worth it to outsource. And that's the balance you try to create. So you can't start with how much are you charging until you talk about what you actually want to offer. And one thing I can give as a piece of advice, don't try to offer everything if you're not good at it, because if you're not good, if you're really good technically, but then offer a couple other outlying services that you're really bad at offering, that's going to taint your whole perspective. They're going to go, hey, yeah, my computers work, but boy, every time I deal with them on all these other issues, they're really difficult. So you have to really think about before you just throw everything in as your offering of focus on things you can offer well. That's the first most important part before you think about the price.
Well, because when you think about what you offer, your clients are going to want to know what you offer. And when I have these conversations with clients, I never start out with a price. I always talk about what is offered. These are the certain things you're going to get with us when we take over your managed services and when we are working with you. So I always, the customer wants to know what you offer. That's the bottom line. You start with that, and then the price just comes out.
And some of the clients, some that are very tech savvy that we work with, we really enjoy them as clients. And one of the reasons they left their previous MSP was the MSP wasn't all or nothing. You either do everything. We hold your internet. We hold your phones. We do it, or you don't use us. And they said, we won't use you. That was their solution. And they've been great clients. We have no reason, you know, I always take it with a grain of salt when someone's complaining about their previous MSP. But when someone tries to offer all services and the client doesn't want it, you're not a good fit. If that's the offer you have to find people that want to accept that. Yeah. We have niched ourselves into being, you know, we don't really do hardware as a service. And a lot of people preach, you have to do hardware as a service. You're leaving money on the table if you don't do it. But some people aren't really into that. You have to figure out what your market niche is. And it's not that I'm thinking those people are wrong offering it. We are just pursuing different avenues and different clients. By the way, this is Tom in October of 2021. There could be a future Tom that's talking about hardware as a service. So don't get mad at this Tom, because hey, things change, life change. But this is where we're at right now.
Good point to me. Yeah. Well, and then we also talked about, you know, when you're looking at what you charge, what's your employee cost?
Yes.
You know, how much is that going to be? And what are your thoughts on that, Tom?
Well, first, let's start with the tooling costs. There's an assumption that if you're paying, let's say, a couple dollars per endpoint, that means you'll just triple it or quadruple that cost per endpoint. Yeah. The reality is that few dollars a month you pay when you're starting out, it starts to add up and you're like, hey, I'm managing 400, 500 systems times $5 a month, $10 a month. That seems like a lot until you have staff. And you can't just go on the tooling costs. And the most important thing, and I've run into so many people who are stuck, and we've talked to them, we've done a little coaching, and Brett does some of the business coaching. That's actually how I met Brett, but a little background on that. But if you don't price your services as if you have employees, even though you don't, you won't ever have employees. Right. This is where people really get stuck. They just look at the cost and go, I'm making great money. Matter of fact, that's a good thing to think about. You will probably make a lot of money when you're doing it yourself. There's a time at which you can keep doing it yourself for quite a while without any employees, make a whole lot of money. But if you aren't pricing it so you can eventually fill someone in a job, and don't get me wrong, you'll enjoy that time when you're going, man, I'm just me. I'm enjoying this. I'm loving it. About a year into it, you're like, I would love a day off. I would love not to be the one person that the entire world falls on all the time. I need to hire someone. And if you didn't price it, because that's what people will be stuck on going, everyone loves me. I gained all these clients. And I'm like, yeah, how do you take it off? Well, I don't, because I never priced it so I could ever fill anyone in a position. So you have to be thinking of this like the day one you're putting your costing together.
Right. You gotta price accordingly on everything. Because when you go to raise your prices, that's going to cause some distension within your clientele.
Yeah.
So price it right up front, and there's less, you're going to have to raise prices once in a while,
right?
But less often when you do it right up front.
Right. And you got to remember the cost of living goes up. There are increases. As that small increase happens, as long as you're at the minimum, your price costing model should at least raise at the cost of inflation. If not, you're losing money. If you made $1 million this year and you did $1 million next year, unless there was 0% inflation, which I don't think that's ever happened, Brett, but
no, you not.
Technically didn't make as much money the next year. So at the minimum, you're doing that. At the other side of it, you should be increasing it. And this is something your clients are going to understand, because everyone has increased prices around them. Cost of this went up, cost of that went up, cost of insurance went up, the cost of managing computers went up. But you can't go in there and say, I'm going to do a 30, 40% price hike because I decided now I need to hire employees. That's a little bit harder of a conversation to have. And it also, from their own perspective, you're like, oh, you didn't plan to have employees. This is your client talking back to you when you slap them with a big price increase. They're like, oh, I guess you never thought about actually having people. I thought you would offer these services for a really low cost forever. You know, you make an awkward conversation versus, hey, you need to do about a 5 or 10% price increase because that, you know what? My insurance costs more, or this costs more, or these factors have changed in the world. And that's a more understandable conversation. So it's just something to think about and keeping the perspective on there of how you manage your business.
Absolutely. And that's a perfect segue into other costs.
Yes.
What are some of the other costs that are involved when you have, are you renting space?
Yeah.
Your equipment costs money, and the right equipment costs money. So you've got to take those into consideration as well, because at some point everything has a useful life. You're going to have to replace that equipment at some point as well. So all of these factors have to take, you need to take into consideration.
Yeah. And this is, and when we say equipment, that there's the tangible, like the physical things you may use.
Right.
And then there's a little bit less tangible, but there may be different training things you need to do and things you need to invest in yourself. You still have to factor that in. You still have to think about, all right, am I going to take another course? Do I have to get a certification? Do I have to keep up with any type of, how would I describe it? All the different things in the industry, sometimes that you have to keep educating yourself on. So you're being on top of things that may require either you spin up a lab in the cloud so you can better understand something that has a cost that's recurring, or you have a physical location to put it in. We have chose the physical location route, but you don't have to. It's not like everybody needs a building. I would say you need a professional address, which you can get for very, very little money at most cities here in the US. There's usually places that offer this. They'll offer you like a building address, not just a PO box, and do it for very little money where you don't actually go there. You can still work out of your house. You can still have all your staff remote. That's perfectly fine and acceptable. But, it's just something you want to decide. And you have to kind of decide that early, because if you are going to take on the burden of doing physical hardware like we do, you have to have a place to set that up. Or maybe you have a really big house and you can do it there. And just all these little factors have to be worked into your equation when you're doing it. And the last one is, how's insurance looking, Brett? Brett came from the insurance industry for context.
That's my mainstay and background. Hey, it prices have gone up. When you think about cybersecurity insurance now, this is something that the insurance companies are struggling to really price. And when insurance companies struggle to price things, they just price them higher until they figure it out.
Yep.
So, those costs are associated with every point of our pricing. Yes. And also you got to make a profit, right? Yeah. You didn't build a business. You aren't starting a business just to break even. You also have to make a profit.
Yeah.
And what you offer, your tool set, your RMM, your employee cost, other costs all have to come into that factor. And then what's your margin?
Yeah.
That's important.
At the end of the day, you should be making some money. If not, it's not a sustainable model. It's not like I'm saying here, be greedy or anything like that. It's more about finding a sustainable model, finding a good living that you can make out of this. It does take a long time, but these are some of the things I wanted people to think about. So I can send them this video as a reply to how much do you charge or how much should I charge is actually the question I see in forums and things like that. And so me and Brett just wanted to kind of throw this out there, address it, give you a couple ideas, a couple things to think about on there for price points. These are guidelines for a formula because I don't want to throw out a pricing out there because that's one, very limited. It's going to change with markets, labor rates. You know, if you are here in Michigan where we are, it costs a whole lot less to live here than it does in certain areas of like California or
the West
where Brett was from. I mean, it's crazy. Just the housing prices are so dramatically different from areas. So those are all things that factor into what you should charge. But I'd like to, this as a guideline so you can at least have some ideas what to think about so you can start throwing things in there. But what are you offering? Tooling costs, staffing costs, insurance, building, vehicles, type cost, and go. And hopefully make money at the end of the day.
That's right. All right. So thank you all for listening. This is Coffee with Tom and Brett, Business Talks, and what we do every day and how we want to help you.
Yeah. We're going to try and do these every Tuesday. Don't hold us to it, but we're trying.
It's in the calendar.
We're struggling for names too. So also leave comments down below if you have a good idea for what we should call this or other things you want to hear. Me and Brett do read the comments. So thank you.
Thank you.